Lydia, I'll start really in the most basic way. Where are we right now?
We are sitting in what would have been the corridor of my apartment in Algiers. Only there aren't actually any walls, but instead I just kind of reassembled thousands of objects and pieces of furniture and the doors of the apartment that I was living in Algiers for the past 2 years.
And these objects then that are here, who do they belong to, or how did you end up living with them?
So the apartment was completely furnished. When I moved in, I mean, it was funny because it was the 34th apartment that I'd looked at when I was looking for places to live in Algiers. And
34th?
Yeah. And this was the only place that would rent to me. The other places wouldn't because I was a single woman, and so I wasn't allowed to rent. And yeah, when I came into this apartment, what was so striking was that they hadn't actually removed a lot of the objects that belonged to the aunt who had recently passed away at the time of my moving in. And so I started opening cabinets and finding, like, you know, half-used candles or like photographs, handkerchiefs. I opened the closets and there were like stacks of bedding, plates, like everything. It was as if someone was living there and I just kind of stepped in. And I remember I moved in with one suitcase, so I started using everything in the apartment. And slowly over the course of the 2 years, as I was bringing like some of my belongings in, I would just slot them in kind of around what was already there, because I felt like I didn't want to disrupt like the order of what that that was too much.
And now you're literally taking care of those things in the process of kind of making them, putting them on view, making them your exhibition. This mix of things that belong to someone else and that belong to you and that you installed in that space.
Care is such an interesting word. I've been thinking about that, like when someone passes away, for example, that their loved ones would be the ones that would deal with the material matter that they had left behind. And that process of kind of going through people's objects and having to make decisions as to what is worth keeping, maybe, or like what is not so interesting, what can be discarded. And, you know, I think I really felt that actually installing this show, like looking through everything as if like it wasn't mine. And I just, like, there was a kind of neutrality that descended upon the room. And the apartment, like seeing it installed in here, where I felt like I was coming into the objects with a completely different narration, where it was that kind of, the spirit of that place had like passed, and now I had to deal with the material effects of it. And to make, I think that really is somehow made legible in, you know, the decision to put certain things in places or to hide certain things.
In fact, this is a show where you've talked to the team of Kunsthalle Basel and you've said, you know, a visitor could open drawers, could open cabinets, could rifle through books.
I wonder what that would do to the kind of meticulous like order that I've put onto the surfaces and into the objects. I wonder what it would mean if the audience had the agency to disrupt that.
Because effectively for 2 years you lived amongst them. Their position in the apartment sort of determined your movements in the space, whether or not you would bring a tray up to serve tea to friends, kind of living in the shoes of someone else almost a little bit. And when I invited you to do a solo show at Kunsthalle Basel, your proposal was this, to actually bring all of these items, those that were yours, those that were hers, including appliances, including refrigerators and washing machines and the front doors to Basel, and to in effect recreate the apartment. But I wonder, how close a reconstruction is it?
I know that this room isn't the same size as the apartment, and things have become more spread out in the layout in this room. But, you know, once something is like busy functioning, it's impossible to see its inner workings because it's in a continuous movement. And then when it suddenly stops, it's almost as if the armor kind of becomes loose and falls off. And then you're able to see the flesh underneath. And in a way, you know, kind of what has been the most intense process of this show was like finally unpacking everything and seeing it, and then having to understand it in a completely shifted position.
I wonder if you could speak a bit about how a project like this one connects to your earlier works, to so many of your pieces which examine, unravel colonial histories and the way in which those histories are inscribed on bodies. It was certainly one of the things that fascinated me about previous pieces of yours I'd seen.
I think it might be useful to speak a bit about In the Absence of Our Mothers, which is the toothpiece. So that work, began in 1942 and finished in 2018.
I love that, by the way. That would be like the first artwork that I know of where the artist herself locates the origins of the piece, or the beginning of the piece, before she was even born.
It really began from this story that I'd heard about my grandfather, who was in the French army, but he was, everyone had to do military service, so he was doing a 2-year compulsory service. And then he was forced to stay in the French army for 13 years more because he was an excellent sniper and they asked him to train other soldiers. And then it was coming towards the end of World War II, and the French had lost so much of their army on the front line, so they began pulling from the colonies. And so he was asked to go and fight in Germany on behalf of the French, and he absolutely did not want to. And I think it's rumored that this was happening on various occasions, that, you know, one way to be dismissed from the army was if you were disabled, and the easiest way to become disabled was not being able to eat. And so he decided, he had like a 2-week break, and he decided to extract every single one of his teeth. And when he went back to the army, they dismissed him on the grounds of, you know, he wouldn't survive if he went to war. But for me, you know, what was so powerful about this gesture of extracting one's teeth is that, like, for him it was really the only way out. And it was, he would rather do that, inflict that violence upon himself, than have to serve the colonizer and fight on their behalf. So then, fast forward to 2015, when I'd met a guy in a market in Oran, and he was selling this woman's gold chain, and I asked him, how much was it? And he said it was 300 euros. And I kind of walked away, and then what struck me about that figure was at the time I was doing a lot of work around illegal immigration from Algeria to Spain, and this was the price that people were charging for a seat in a boat to Europe. And then when I asked him where he got the chain from, he said it was my mother's and she wanted me to sell it for her. But then somehow when he mentioned that figure of 300 euros, I imagined, like, what if he stole this chain from his mother and he's selling it in order to flee? And something about that gesture of, like, to go against your own flesh and blood as the only way for your escape brought me back to the story of my grandfather pulling out his teeth as the only form of escape. And it was like both gestures were situated in the same space of, like, they were both permanent. It's no going back from that. And so I decided to have the chain melted down into two gold teeth and have one implanted in my mouth. Which you can just about see if I smile.
So this would be one example, but there would be many others where colonial histories, capital H and small h, and the way in which they sort of, the impact that they have on bodies became a recurrent line of force through your work. But the particularity is, rather than treating them like histories with a capital H, they always became histories that, in the same way that your grandfather pulled his own teeth, you pulled your own. You've cut off your own hair.
I've made myself homeless.
You've made yourself homeless. You've brought all of your worldly possessions here, and will be forced to kind of live without them for the duration of the exhibition. Mm-hmm. And that, I find that very fascinating, because it's rather rare.
You know, all of these stories and all of these accounts are held actually within your genetic makeup, and they are held within the body.
So tell me something about the lasers that traverse the exhibition and even traverse the courtyard of Kunsthalle Basel.
You know, in military use, lasers are used as a way of targeting a person or an object or a building. But the impetus for my use of lasers within this show wasn't so much about the target as it was about the disruption. And what the sound that you hear within the exhibition is actually the sound of the elemental disruption on the laser beam, which is going from the back of the room across the courtyard and into the front, and then mirroring itself into the space, so that when people walk through the beam, which is following this line of elemental disruption, the passing of bodies in between that laser also further disrupts the signal from being able to transmit. So actually, when people cut the light, they also cut the sound. I mean, it implicates the body of the viewer, I think, in like the discontinuation of the circuit. Like, their very presence means that, within the light beam, means that they stop it from being able to function as I want it to. And you register that dysfunction.
And while that happens, while these bodies walking through the beam of light stop sound, if that same body speaks, if they mumble, if they get sort of, as they work through the room, their footsteps kind of creates sound that then get captured by one of five different bugging devices that you have in the space, right?
Yes.
And unusually shaped, unusual looking bugging devices, I should add.
So there's five bugging devices that we've developed in the space. they function in two ways. So there's a GSM device in it, which is basically a phone number. So one of the microphones that is on the surface of this bug is a phone line that people can call into and listen to the exhibition and whatever sounds that might be happening in this room. And simultaneously, another like FM transmitter is picking up live sound from the space itself. So if there were people walking around, speaking, making any kind of movement. But also, I think what's interesting as a connection with the laser beam and the bugs is that the main function of the laser beam is that it is a microphone. So even though it is simultaneously carrying the sound, it's also recording sound. So people walking around the room is read by the laser beam, which is coming out of the sound system. And that's also being picked up by the FM transmitters. So it's kind of creating this feedback loop of information, which at the root of it all requires bodies to be present, actually, for there to be information on that end.
But it also means effectively, you know, even in those hours when we are closed, or even in the moment when the show is not yet open to the public, but on in a way, because it's getting turned on now with your presence here, someone could call in, and the numbers are the titles of the works themselves. So the number is very public, is very known. They could call a number and they could hear what's happening within your exhibition space. They could effectively be spying on your show.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's tethering, you know, I'm kind of giving these points where people can still be tethered to the exhibition, even through not being able to experience every aspect of it. But there's still like a mode of connection which is possible. I'm super interested in surveillance, which somehow like is trying to behave in a normal way. So like hiding bugs within ornaments. You know, this was really important when I was thinking about like how household objects or ornaments can indeed be these very revealing and violent objects, which are trying to kind of camouflage themselves into your domestic environment. Like, I think that about the Alexa, for example. And I was thinking, I was looking into, the shapes of the bugging devices are these kind of elongated skulls. And skull elongation was this practice which was discovered throughout time, throughout various civilizations. There's no understanding as to how this practice was communicated throughout these different civilizations, but it existed all over the world. And the one common thread was that it was thought that if you had a longer skull, you were somehow closer to the spirits. And it was also to do with this idea of the unfinished self.
I think that's super interesting, because this idea of the shape of the blown glass vessels in which you have your bugging device are, as you've so beautifully recounted, connected to this mysterious practice that no one has yet been able to explain about why so many different cultures would elongate their skull in order to be closer to the spirits. And this kind of comes back to the title of your show, and this idea of where we are right now, the limbo that we sit in and that your show situates. Can you say something about the title?
The title is Barzakh, which is the Arabic term to describe limbo. But it's really, it has many different translations. Some of them are, it's kind of this space that when you die, your spirit waits in before its fate is decided. And the other translation is, it's a thin strip of land between two seas, so like a refuge, not an island, but a kind of resting point. But it's not a space of purgatory or suffering. It really is like just a moment of relief. I mean, I think about like how charged things become when they're waiting, and almost how much I had charged the idea of my home or these objects whilst they were in Algiers, and that charge is what brought them here, because I somehow needed them to be activated somehow. But then bringing them here, I realized that they are again like suspended in a state of waiting.
So maybe that brings me to the last question. Will they go back, and will you go back? I mean, will this ever be constituted as a home again? Or what, if they're now in limbo, what will their future fate be?
I mean, these objects will for sure return because I've borrowed them, and it was always part of the agreement that I would return the apartment to exactly how it was, which I think will also be interesting to see these objects trying to go back and how they will reconfigure themselves again into that place having been in a different air. As for myself, I can never answer that with certainty. For now.